All right, guys, we're finally here with Spider-Man No Way Home. Did Sony pull it off, giving us a great film, or did they ruin the franchise trying to force a Sinister Six movie? Let's talk about it. My name is Brandon Keith Avery, and this is just my opinion. Hey, what's going on, everyone, and welcome back to another episode of Just My Opinion for my movie review for Spider-Man No Way Home. And if this is your first time finding me and you happen to like the video, please give me that thumbs up and consider subscribing. All right, guys, if you did not know already, Spider-Man is one of my most favorite comic book characters of all time. I mean, you have Spider-Man, Blade, Black Panther, Batman, and maybe the Hulk. Those are like my top five right there. But Spider-Man, that's like number one, number two, especially probably number three. It's not below number three. And I have really enjoyed the Spider-Man films in the MCU so far, especially with Civil War where he debuted. I was worried going into Homecoming and Far From Home, but I walked out of those films actually very satisfied, thinking to myself, okay, Sony, I was worried, but you did a great job. And maybe because my expectations were so low, but I still have to give credit where credit is due. I also felt the same way with No Way Home. I thought this was a desperate attempt of Sony trying to force a Sinister Six movie on us, and that is something that I do want to see. But if you know Spider-Man, if you know the lore, you know the comics, you know the story, they have enough material to have at least 15 solo Spider-Man movies on top of him going into other Disney Plus shows and other MCU movies, etc. So I'm like, why are we rushing this right now? Y'all are going to ruin this. This is just a desperate attempt to maintain the character because you guys don't know what you're doing. And I'm here to talk about whether they succeeded or not. Now, this is also being directed by John Watts, who also directed the first two Spider-Man films in the MCU over at Sony. And he's also going to be directing the Fantastic Four movie that was announced in the MCU as well. So at least that franchise is in good hands for the most part. And like going into this, like, I love Spider-Man, but my expectations were low. But before I get into all the nitty-gritty and all that good stuff, I want to let you know that this review is going to be brief because I just literally got done shooting, recording a 2-hour spoilery discussion with Elliot from Movie Files, and here is his channel right here, and also E-Man's with E-Man's Movie Reviews. We talked for over 2 hours about this movie, going into all the nitty-gritty. E-Man came a little late, so when you watch that, if he's not there in the very beginning, that is why. But make sure you subscribe to my channel and come back for that. That review will be posted on my channel on Thursday, December the 16th at 3 p.m. CST. That's Thursday, December 16th at 3 p.m. CST. But before I get into all the nitty-gritty again about my likes and dislikes in this non-spoiler review, let me tell you exactly what it's all about. With Spider-Man's identity now revealed, Peter asks Dr. Strange for help. When a spell goes wrong, dangerous foes from other worlds start to appear, forcing Peter to discover what it truly means to be Spider-Man. And guys, I have to say, after reading that last sentence, where forcing Peter to discover what it truly means to be Spider-Man, I agree with that wholeheartedly. And I have to say, that's actually one of the best things that I did like about this movie, is the journey that Peter Parker, Tom Holland, had to go through and the development of his character. He's a child, he is in high school, he has fought Thanos, he's been in space, you know, he has saved the world. And so he's not your average teenager. You know, he still wants to be a child, but at the same time, he's growing up much faster than he wanted. Now, he still does make ridiculous decisions that can be idiotic in this film, and it is very frustrating. I'm like, Peter, what are you doing? Why are you beefing with Dr. Strange? He's much older than you. He has much wisdom. He knows what he's doing. And that's just part of his development. And I hated his character for that, for the most part. But at the same time, I'm like, he's still a child. But there was a ton of lessons that he learned in this movie, especially by the time that we get to the end. And I really do like the way they matured his character overall. I thought that was perfect. One of the other great things I liked about this movie is the way that it started off. It starts off exactly where Far From Home leaves off. So it has that perfect continuity. And one of the characters that we know from the Raimi films back in the 2000s is the addition of J.K. Simmons as J. Jonah Jameson. We only got a brief snippet of him in a mid-credit or post-credit scene in Far From Home, and now he is all throughout this movie. He was great as J. Jonah Jameson in the Sam Raimi films, and he's great in this as well. And I can't wait to see more of him. He's not the head of a newspaper because, to my understanding, people don't really read newspapers like that anymore. He's more of an online digital blogger, and that makes perfect sense. And so I love the addition of J.K. Simmons as J. Jonah Jameson in this film. I also love the fact that the very beginning is we actually got to see Spider-Man swinging from buildings in New York. That's something that we really didn't get in Homecoming. At the very end of that film, he was driving a car. And also in Far From Home, he was over in Europe in a foreign land for the duration of that film, for the most part. We got him swinging from buildings at the end of that film, but that was at the very end. And this film, we don't get that. We get it at the very beginning of him swinging from buildings in New York in the daytime. In the middle of the film, we get to see him swinging from sewers, and we also get to see him swinging from buildings at nighttime. And you may be saying to yourself, Brandon, I mean, Spider-Man swinging from buildings, why is that such a big deal for you? I mean, that's part of what makes Spider-Man cool, is seeing him swing from buildings. And it seems like a simple concept that a studio would not leave out of their film, but for some reason Sony wanted to, but they did not, you know, do that in the case of this film. I love that. I love what they did there. Something else that's great in this film is the comedy. I did laugh a lot in this movie, and I want to say a lot more than I usually do. That doesn't say that the comedy is perfect. I mean, there are a few moments where they could have dialed it back just a little bit, but for the most part, you know, it was perfectly timed. It was perfectly executed, and I really don't have any complaints there. I can bring up other MCU movies to where they tried to be funny during serious moments, and that ruined the tension. I'm proud to say that that's not the case in this film as well. Now, something that they did accomplish in this movie that could have been quite difficult is them balancing all the characters, bringing them into the fold and explaining why they're there, and it just making narrative sense. And for the most part, it does make narrative sense. I mean, it makes sense why all the characters, I don't want to go down and list them because you know that they're there from the trailers. But the person that stole the show for me was Dr. Octopus, you know, Alfred Molina. It may be because Spider-Man 2, where he debuted back in the 2000s, 2004, I think universally that film is still most people's favorite Spider-Man film, and he was great in that. So that's probably why he got a lot of screen time in this, but, you know, he did a great job, especially him and Willem Dafoe. Doc Ock did a better job to me, but I think that's just because he had more screen time than Willem Dafoe as the Green Goblin, but he did a great job too. And we also, guys, we come to these films because we want to see the action, and the action is dope as hell. When Doc Ock first shows up and he's battling Peter Parker, I don't want to say exactly the mechanics of how they were fighting because there was a large aspect of it in the film that wasn't in the trailer, and I don't want to ruin it for you, but I was over here going like, oh, that was cold, that was clean, oh, I liked that. The choreography is quite nice. I love that you can tell that they really sat down and was like, what are all the abilities of Doc Ock, what are all the abilities of Spider-Man, and what surrounding devices can we have for them to use at their advantage, whether it's a concrete embankment, a pillar, some type of cone in a road, or a car. And they use all of that and combine it together and choreograph a great scene with their abilities, and it's just dope to see them on screen fighting each other using their abilities. And it's very creative and innovative, and I really did like that right there. Unfortunately, all of the characters in this movie do not get the same level of attention and detail, but when those characters do get that love, detail, care, and all that, it is phenomenal. And I really did like the fight between Doc Ock and Peter Parker, Spider-Man. I thought it was dope as hell. I loved everything about that. Another great thing about this movie is it is very heartfelt. There are some sad moments. There are some happy moments. It's going to make you emotional. When I saw this, I think I heard a couple of people crying at a few moments in this film. But, I mean, it's earned, okay? It is earned, and I'll just say that right there. Something else that I really did like about this film and the whole MCU is how they treat the general public as far as their reception to superheroes. And at the very beginning of this film, you know, Peter, he's wanted for murder, for murdering Mysterio, if you've seen him Far From Home. And I really do like the way that people reacted to it. It's very realistic. You know, they had a couple of Karens in this movie that were reacting to the news as well as, you know, Peter Parker, Spider-Man, potentially being a villain, a monster, a murderer. And I like that. You know, I didn't like the characters in the movie because it's designed that way, but it is something that I really did also appreciate. Now, there are a ton of surprises in this movie. Of course, I'm not going to spoil anything for you here. There was a ton of speculation, like, is this character going to pop up or this character going to pop up? Of course, you're just going to have to see the movie yourself to determine if they did pop up or not, you know, but there's a number of surprises in this film. Some I saw coming, some I didn't see coming. Even the surprises that I did see coming, I was still smiling, and then I was smiling even bigger from the surprises that I didn't see coming. So don't be surprised when you're surprised. And the inclusion of Doctor Strange in this movie was cool too. One of the things that I have not liked about how Spider-Man has been introduced in the MCU is he gets help from everybody. In the first two films, he was helped by Tony Stark. In this film, he is being helped by Doctor Strange. And that's just kind of annoying to me. I mean, it makes sense that these characters are in the same universe, so of course they're gonna bounce off of each other. But the Spider-Man that I know and love, that I grew up with, is he's a genius in himself, and he figures out a lot of this stuff on his own. And that's just one of the disappointing aspects of this film. But I am glad to say that the way the film ended, I am pretty satisfied with, I think, where they're gonna take it. I think we're gonna eventually get that Spider-Man that I do want to see. A couple of gripes that I do have is that some of the villains just didn't get enough screen time as the others. And they just came across weaker. I mean, when you're comparing them all on screen together, it's kind of unbalanced because this person is getting so much shine where this person isn't. I mean, there were some points I was like, you know, this person shouldn't have even been in the movie. It would have been better and not wasted so much screen time if they would have set this one out. And going all the way to the final battle scene, it was done at nighttime, which you see in the trailers. And that was kind of a problem for me because you can barely see what's going on. And they do that, shoot scenes at nighttime, to hide a lot of the CGI that can't be composed the right way. So that's very noticeable with the Sandman and Electro's ability played by Jamie Foxx. And so that is kind of a knock right there. Other complaints that I have about the film, I really can't address right now without spoiling the film. And I don't want to spoil anything for you. It's best that you go into this film not knowing anything. But it is something that I did enjoy overall. I had a lot of fun and I wouldn't mind going to go see this again. And I want to talk more about it, but I don't want to spoil it for you guys. But just make sure you subscribe to my channel and come back to check out our epic long 2-hour spoilery discussion with Elliot from Movie Files and Emmanuel from E-Man's Movie Reviews. If I had to go ahead and, well, I'll go ahead and give my rating for this film at the very end, guys, but that is just my opinion. And I want to thank you so much for tuning in. If you did enjoy this video, please go ahead and give me the thumbs up and also subscribe to the channel. Help me reach my next milestone of 35,000 subscribers and then eventually to 100K. I will get there. And if I had to rate Spider-Man No Way Home out of a 1 out of 10, I think I'm going to give this film an 8 or an 8.5 out of 10, an 8 or an 8.5 out of 10. I can't decide if I want to give it an 8 or 8.5 out of 10, but I'm just going to stick it right there. But guys, again, I just want to thank you all so much for tuning in. And before you go, don't forget that my name is Brandon Keith Avery, and that's just my opinion. Peace.